Okie dokie. Apparently my day is going just as well as expected. There we go. Okay, good morning to everybody. Apparently, starting a little bit early just because I'm sitting here at my desk bored, waiting for the time to start, so I figured why not. And also apparently I forgot how to mute stuff, so yeah, whatever. We're starting. It is Friday, October. Okay, let's try this again. Good morning, everybody, or day, or evening, whatever time it is. It is Friday, April 14th, 2017. We're going to start with our live stream. Just kicking it off a little bit early. The plan, like normal, is to work on requests that people may have, if there's anything you can help out with. And if not, we'll be working on our main project, which is this livestream MMO Slice. Let's go ahead and open up our project. I probably should have done this before we started, but again, not paying attention today. It's school break right now for my kids, so I've got a bunch of people in the house, and I don't know how long I'm going to be able to stream for or how focused this is going to be, but I'm going to try my best. So this is building out what we worked on. On Wednesday was we got our targeting card working, so we were successfully able to target something and have their stats show up on our screen as a player, and we were able to get them to update properly. So we're good on that. We didn't actually test it in full multiplayer, so I'm thinking we'll start off the day testing it in full multiplayer, and then we will testing full multiplayer, and then we'll figure out something to work on next. I haven't figured out what I was going to work on today. I kind of like didn't even think about that, but we've got it working. Let's go ahead and open up our client and server, and if I can remember where Explorer is at, there we go. Let me start up the database server. Let me start up the node server. And then let me start up the dedicated server. And let's see about starting up. Whoop, I closed the client. That didn't help. Let's see about starting up our build clients. So here's this one. We'll log him in and make him smaller. And then we'll log in our other guy. Make him smaller over here. There we go. So we should have two clients connected working. Yeah, so we have two clients connected and working. Let me move him over here so he can see stuff. Yeah, there we go. They should be able to target stuff like that. This guy should be able to target an attack. Health bars are going down properly, so we see the health bar in screen going down. Screen going down. Health bar on the target going down. And health bar on the target going down. And I should be able to target an attack. And the health should go down quicker. And it's not. So we have an issue here with multiple people. So it was working fine until I started attacking. Okay, so we definitely have some bugs here. And hello everyone who's in chat. We're not getting rid of our target when we no longer have a target. We can see that here. We have some dummy stuff that shouldn't be here. I also have this one. That one was definitely stuck. So we have some UI issues with our targeting. Shouldn't be that big of a deal. Basically, when we're no longer targeting, when we no longer have a target, our current target is null. then, well, so let's see. Right now, what our current target is null, we're hiding our target. So, whoa, I've also got it showing up on two different screens now. Uh-oh. Oh, why are these the same names? Uh-oh, triple uh-oh. Yeah, okay, so we've definitely got an issue here. Let me restart this and see if we can figure that out. I just noticed our UI was completely messed up. That wasn't good. Okay, this is AWES. He's our warrior. And then DDDD should be our mage, but something's not working right. Nope, something's not working right. You can see he's got the wrong information being displayed on his heads-up display. That's not good. Okay, that might explain why we had an issue with something not meshing with our targeting. Oh, that's kind of cool. So I'm on this client right here. I target this monster and the UI shows up over here. And you can see it's completely different. We'll go over here, we'll target him, and it shows up properly. Target him. It's not showing up. We'll untarget, target. Yep. Okay, so there's something wrong with our replication with multiple clients for some reason. This stuff worked the other day and now it's broken. So we'll have to figure it out. Let me kill this client. And he leaves the server. Let me kill this client. And he leaves the server. So that's fine. Our data is being replicated incorrectly all of a sudden for some reason. That makes no sense to me. Let me see if we can figure this out. Okay, so logging in here is fine. Let's see, I'm looking at our stuff. That's our session ID, AK. We'll log in with a secondary client. Ooh, I just realized I can do that. That's cool. And this should be AAM, which is fine. Yeah, you'll notice. Okay, so it's given me the information for the first person who logged in for some reason. So either my socket ID is wrong or something like that. And then I also should have an issue where, let's see. Yep, I'm targeting something on this screen. It's being replicated to everyone else. The target, the local target. Okay, so let's see. I have a feeling it's the locally controlled. We're not checking for locally controlled on this one. This character right here. So we have this little guy right here. He's targeting this. The target's changing. It's probably replicating it to the server. Or using the rep notify. It's letting the server know who we have. That information is being rep notified to everybody else. So technically, this guy right here is getting the rep notify. He's getting his current target changed. When his current target changes, it's notifying our UI that it needs to target something. So that's what's going wrong there, I bet you. So if we find our character, let's close everything down and let's test that out. I have a feeling that's what it is. Let's kill our server. Let's go to our, let's see, I'm guessing it's going to be in our player. And we need to find where we are targeting stuff. So did I actually comment that somewhere? Or did I just leave that uncommented? No, there's our auto attack. There we go. So left mouse button down. Check and see if we have a current target. Sanity check. Set current target on server. Yeah, so this stuff is all fine. This is our set with our target, current target on server. We should call this. This does the set with notify. So that's fine. The problem is our set with notify right here is checking if it's the client, and this is our target card. This should only be run on the local controller is what it should do. That's what we want to do. So to do, is this pawn locally controlled? So we still want it updated properly. We just only want our UI to update itself when the current target is locally controlled. I think this will work for what we want. Because technically, when we're in the game, the only thing that should be locally controlled should be our current one, our current player. And that's the only time we want the character to update the UI. So let's try building that out. Let's see, Tudis, can we request some stuff? Feel free to request anything. I'll do my best to try to help out with the time that I have and the knowledge that I have. If I can, I will. So yeah, request away. That's the point of the live stuff, is to try to help people out if I can. And then work on other stuff when I'm not helping people out. Which is in between builds right now. So yeah, feel free to request away. I'm hoping this is a simple fix. This is one of those things where it's just a concept of this is the concept of the client-server differences is what this is. Let's run our dedicated server. That would be me clicking the wrong dedicated server. Let's start this dedicated server. Let's go back into here. Let's run our login screen. And we'll log in as D. So nothing should be different because we only have one player. So that's not our concern. Our concern is when we log in our secondary player. I still don't know why our login information is incorrect, because you'll notice this is still wrong and I don't know why. But we're more concerned about the fact that we're clicking on stuff and hit point bars were changing. So I have nothing targeted here. And I have nothing targeted here. I'll target this monster. Nothing changed. Target this monster, nothing changed. Nothing changed. I'm gonna drag this off screen for a second. Click there, nothing changed. Nothing changed, nothing changed. Okay, so I'm pretty sure we're okay now. I can target this, we should see the health going down. Yeah, so that was an issue of, we were not having our controlled player adjusting the correct information. So our bars are going down properly. Only one thing's attacking. Let's target a different one. Correct. Target this one. Correct. Let's turn on his attack. It looks like we fixed the issue with that weird display. The problem is our health bar should stay, and that's fine. We haven't fixed that bug yet. But we have the fact that we have the wrong health bar being displayed, and that was just this right here. So let's put a comment here so we know. Make sure it's only our controlled character that changes his UI. Okay. Spent 2 days researching on how to swap between two weapons. Found nothing. Well, what do you mean by swapping between two weapons? Do you mean physically changing out the models? Do you mean you have two different blueprints and you need to swap them? Are these two different things on the screen? If you can give me a little more information on what you're trying to do. I have a FPS tutorial system where we went through and we added in weapons, and we created weapons that you could pick up and you could change your weapon and things like that. So I have done something like that. Okay, changing blueprints. Well, okay, so let's try to find, let me see what I did with my FPS. Because I'm pretty sure which one was. I literally don't remember which one of these is going to be the, I think it's the prototype. Well, yeah, it looks like it's the prototype. Okay, so you're doing this on, okay, so you're doing this on multiplayer as well. So how do you know the server side is working, but the client doesn't get updated? What's your indication of that? Yeah, it sounds like you might not need this information. It sounds like it might just be a networking issue. So let's see if we can get some more information. Let's see, server side works as intended, but client doesn't get updated. And the client can change the server's values if it's done its own. With server player, my weapon blueprint changes. Okay, so there's a couple things you need to note. When you say server, there's two different types of servers in Unreal Engine. Listen and dedicated. Technically, the listen server is also a client. So that's something to keep in mind. So just because it seems like it's changing on the server doesn't necessarily mean it's changing on the server. It could mean that the client is changing it locally. And that's the only thing that's actually changing, not the actual server version. There are technically three different versions in play if you're looking at a client-client server. Even if that server is a listen server, as in you're firing up with multiple people and your server isn't dedicated. Like in this case, I actually have a dedicated server running. This is something, a completely different version of Unreal Engine running just the server. Nothing connected to it. No players automatically. That would be a dedicated server. If you have the server where you're playing and you can actually control stuff, that's your listen server. From the sounds of it, it sounds like you have a listen server. And it sounds like when you're saying that the server side's working as intended, you're actually updating the client on the server side. You're not actually updating the server. And because of that, that's why your client's not getting updated. The other person. That would be my guess. So let's see if we can break this down, and we'll go over some basics and see if we can cover that. When you're talking about your client and your server, are you talking about two players in the same game? So, I mean, we'll just start with that. Do we have, you know, a multiplayer situation where you have two different people that can see each other? Kind of like how I have two different people set up. Like if I go to here, we do this. Let me log him in. I keep forgetting how to do that. It makes it so much easier. I should probably start these things out smaller too. Okay. So are we talking a multiplayer situation where you have like this, where you have two different people that can see each other? Is that what we're talking about? Two players, listen server. Okay, so we have something like this, but one of these players is actually our server as well. And then when you change the weapon, you're seeing this player change his weapon, but this guy over here can't see him change his weapon. So you're seeing it change locally, but you're not seeing it change remotely. Because if that's the case, chances are you're actually not changing it on the server, you're changing it on the client. And because the server has no idea it changed, the other clients have no idea it changed. The basics with replication, server calls, server authority, and stuff like that, the basic key, and this is what took me a while to figure out, because I've only been doing the networking stuff for a couple months at this point. Clients technically can't change variables or change stats or do any changes that you care about. That's something to keep in mind. Your client never technically can change anything you care about. If you want your client to play a special effect that is only shown on your client, that's fine, because only your client would care about that. But if you want your client to do something that matters, for example, it fires his gun or it changes the weapon, the client doesn't do that. The server does it. And then it tells the clients it's done it, and then the clients react accordingly. I know that seems really weird, but that's the way it works with the client server setup in Unreal Engine. So basically, and I'll say how it works basically, and then I'll show you in code how it works. Basically, even if you have a listen server, it really doesn't matter. All that matters is there is a server somewhere that has control over everything. Your client, so let's say your little dude here, player A, tells the server the weapon changed. Then the server tells the client who just told it that the weapon changed, that its weapon changed. But at the same time, it's telling every other person who's connected, every other client, so our guy over here, that the weapon changed. That's the basics of how you want it to work. It seems really weird, but in code, how it would work is basically, we have our little guy here. So let's say we have a weapon change. So here's our character. And let's say we have the J key. Well, that didn't go to the J key. P key. Oh, come on, can you just hot key me something here? I'm trying not to type in. Seriously, are there no keys that go right to key? Oh, crap. We'll just go with the Y key then, because this thing doesn't like me. Let's find the Y key. Where's the Y key? Seriously? Where's the bikey hiding?
Oh my gosh.
This is so... I want a friggin' input for the Y key. This. I hate trying to find... Just going right to a key in input. Okay, did I break something? Is my... Am I input node? Oh, because I'm... yep, that would be why I'm not inside my event graph. Okay, let's try this again with the actual event graph being opened up this time. So we're going to go with the Y key. There we go. See, look, I found my keys. Okay. So let's say the Y key. Okay, yeah. So that's why we're going to go over it. Yeah. That's why the basic explanation I wanted to cover first, and then we'll go over with our technical explanation. So let's say the Y key is your weapon change key. And let's say you have a variable in here called current weapon. And let's say this is an... let's say it's a weapon blueprint. I'm just going to go with actor. But let's say this is your weapon blueprint. So this is your weapon. So it's your spawned weapon. It's your reference, your weapon. I don't know how you're doing your weapon spawning and despawning stuff, but let's say this is your weapon itself. And this has a reference to the weapon, whether it's an attached item or something. For our example, it's not going to matter. All that matters is we have something we're going to change. When you push the Y key, this is going to happen locally. Doesn't matter if it's listen server or not, it's going to happen locally. What you need to do is say, hey, server, I just did something. So you need a server event. So we'll call this one, for example, change weapon pressed. And actually type, oh, I did a custom event. Change weapon pressed. And for now, we're just going to change this into run on server. And then we'll explain in a second slight differences. And then what you do here is you do change weapon pressed. Now, I know this seems silly, but this is how it has to work. Yeah, let's go over this, and then we can may have to slightly change it to do your changes, but this is what's going to matter. This is the important part. As long as we get this stuff understood, then you just think about, okay, who needs to know about this, and then you notify the appropriate people. So when we hit the Y key, we're saying, hey, let's call change weapon pressed. This is just a function or an event somewhere. But the key with this one is this one is set to call run on server. When we are playing our game, so let's say, for example, I hit play and I type in my name. This doesn't matter for you, but let's say you're playing on your game. And I'm not going to be able to log in because I've changed my server, of course. Here, I can easily go to, where's my map? Here we go. Let's go to my playground map, and then let's go with a two-player version like that, and hit play. Oh, stupid server. Hold on a second. Bear with me here. Close. I have things set up a certain way in here for testing purposes, so this does not help. For what I'm trying to show, of course. Okay, there we go. So we have, this is the stuff that you have basically in yours. And ignore the way it looks because this is my test map. We have what looks like two people here, but we don't have two people here. We technically have three, and that's kind of the important thing that matters here. We have the server version of everything. Then we have client 1's version of everything and client 2's version of everything. I know it says client 1, whatever. It doesn't matter. Every single person who's connected to the server has their version of everything. And the server has its own version of everything. But the server is what's in charge of everything. What you do is you have your client tell the server to change its version. And then you tell everybody else to listen to those changes and get notified when those changes happen. And that's what matters. So that's what I was trying to say. It's one of those things that took me a little while to get my head around, the fact that you have to remember that there's another version of everything you probably don't see that's on the server. That even though you've made a change and it looks like you made a change, it doesn't mean the server has any idea about it. So in this case, our local version is going to say, hey, go ahead and run this command. on the server. So our server version of this character is going to now take over, and it's going to run this command. And then in here, this is where you change your weapon out. So for example, I could grab current weapon, and I could set the current weapon. Well, I'd actually set it to, you know. You would change your current weapon to whatever you want. Whatever your command is, or whatever you, however you change it on your character, this is where you would call it. What this will do is now your server is going to change or do whatever commands you want. So your server version of your character will now be different than your client versions. What matters here after this is how do you want your clients to be notified of the change? You either have to run a command on the clients to tell them to do something, or you run the command on the server and tell it to do it to everything. Or if it's a variable that's changed, if the variable is set to replicated or replicated notify, it will change automatically. So for example, you see, let's see, you have weapon one spawned in hand, weapon two on back, and by playing an animation, there are two notifies which tell one to detach and get a new one from the back. Okay. The animation itself doesn't really need to be run on the server. That's something that sounds like it could be fired off on the client. It sounds like, okay, so when you're actually switching the weapons themselves, it sounds like it's just you're setting an animation. You're basically firing off an animation to switch the weapon. Is that what it is? And then do you change any variables to let your character know which weapon they're using, or what else do you change? It's in the state machine. Okay. So do you have a screenshot of the code you actually fire off in the character? Because it might be a simple case of you doing this right here. And then firing off whatever code that, you know, this is, I'll just do a print string here, run animation code. It might be as simple as doing something like this. Depending on whatever you do to change it. What this does is say, hey, local client, you want to do this code. This code is saying, hey, I'm going to run on the server. And on the server, I'm also going to tell everybody else to call this event locally. I can look at the file, but it might be easier just to send me the screenshot. I'll be on for about an hour or so. I can try testing it out. I can look at it after as well. But this is probably what you're looking for, basically. If you have code that runs, if I could just see the screenshot of your change weapon code, basically, probably this is all you need to do. Whatever you have set up after your key switch, so right now, for example, you might have this code in place. So we can just move these over here like this, ignore those. This might be your current code. Your current code is, hey, I'm gonna hit the button to change the weapon and something fires off. Your current code might actually be something like unconnect this. So this is our current code to run. And we're gonna actually go ahead and hook that up to a little multicast event, and we call the multicast event. And what this does is say, hey, instead of running this code locally, talk to the server and run this code. And this code goes, hey, oh, I'm going to run everything that follows this after on the server and on the clients. And that should tell the server to execute that code locally. So the server will update itself. And then it'll also tell all the clients to fire off this code, which means it should change, you know, fire off your animation and work. More than likely, that's what you're going to want to do. I have a feeling that's what you'd want. But yeah, feel free to toss out that screenshot. We'll see if we can help in regards to that. For now, we'll just leave this here. And what were we working on? Oh yeah, for some reason, loading up the character's information is giving us bad information when we have a second client loading in. Which means I broke the server somehow, which is probably not my goal here. So let me open up Visual Studio Code. I've was hoping we didn't have to do any server stuff, but apparently I broke something somehow in our loading code. So let's just really quickly run through this. Here's our check for existing character. And if we found someone, we say that we did find someone. Attempt to log in. Where is our code that returns back our character? Check if this data is in the load from databases. Return back source session ID. No, that's the login. This is our register code. This is existing character code. Create new character code. Get character info and send to client. Okay, here we go. So this is what I'm looking for right here. Our session IDs must not be storing properly. Are we duplicating session IDs somehow? Which we shouldn't. There should be no way that session ID should ever be duplicated because session IDs go on the username. And I'm actually looking at the code from the last time where we killed something, and it showed we have two unique session IDs. So that's not it. So I broke my code somehow. Okay, let's quickly walk through this and see what we did wrong. So let me, so we need our login helper. So let's find our login helper. And our login helper is going to do a login request, check for existing character. We're gonna check for an existing character on the server. We are gonna grab our session ID, pass our session ID in. This is our unique identifier into check for existing character. Check for existing character is this code right here. If it returns back true or false, so we'll check for existing character, and that should be a check for existing character return. And if it comes back with a true, then we are going to load up the server. Yeah. Huh. So where is the, where am I actually loading up the data? That's actually a good question. What's my character? I think I forgot what I was doing. Here we go. Receive character info from server. Here we go. So this is where we grab the info from the server, and this updates our HUD. So this info is coming back incorrectly. So where do we do the send character info from server? Let's find our event graph. Let's find our custom event graph. It'll probably be in our begin play. We'll talk to the server. We do our connect. We do our listeners. We grab our game instance on the remote. Yeah, on our remote, we grab our game instance, so that shouldn't be an issue. Huh. We update the session ID on the server. Which is setting our session ID for this client. Well, it looks like I'm gonna have to walk through this. Let's see, what's the difference between a teleport node and a set world location? Teleport node is basically just a shortcut node. And if we do the teleport node and we do the set world location, you can technically do the same thing. Let's see, that'd be set actor location. So there's a couple things. So you'll notice the buttons down here. This right here, if we have teleport checked, is basically the same thing. You'll notice, though, that on the teleport, you have the ability to change the rotation. And on the set actor location, you could actually do a sweep, which will give you hit results if we hit something on the way. Teleport is basically just a shortcut node. That's all it is. Yeah. It's basically our set actor location node with teleport turned on. So move from one. This moves it instantly. Physics is not affected, and it will not check for anything colliding in the way. Set actor location, if you turn on sweep, can check for something in the way. If you do it like this, physics is affected. So the teleport option basically disables physics when it moves. So that's the other shortcut. It just depends on what you want to do. If you want to move something instantly, use the teleport node. If you want to move something and check for collision, use the set actor location node. That's probably the easiest way of thinking about it. No, use whichever one's appropriate. For example, if I'm moving something over time, then I would set the location. That way I can use collisions. if I'm going to move something instantly, then I would teleport. Like, for example, a good example is somebody dies and you're going to respawn them somewhere else. Just teleport them rather than setting. Set actor location technically doesn't drag them to the spot unless you've turned on certain options. Set actor location moves it from one spot to another. So let's say we have nothing turned on here. It's going to go from one point to the other. And if there's physics on here, so you have a chain hooked up, for example. If it's a large distance, the chain is going to freak out because all of a sudden its physics has moved from one location to another. And all of the velocity applied for that change is going to make the chain freak out because it had a huge change. That's by default. That's why our teleport, for example, ignores that. If you click the teleport option on the set actor location, it basically does the same thing. It'll shut off physics while it's moving. So it's an instant movement without physics applied. Sweep allows it to move it slowly, instantly, but slowly, and we'll check and see if anything is in the way and then collide with it if needed. So you just pick whichever one's appropriate. Yeah, if you're doing a death system, I'd recommend teleport because it moves it over to another location instantly. You want it to get to that location. You don't care about what's in the way. The theme is we're still working on our MMO thingy. And apparently I broke something on our login helper, which I'm totally confused on. I'm not going to not lie on that one. So we need to start doing some debug stuff to figure out what we did wrong. This is our exist. In our character itself, this is where we get our information from the server. This is where we call the load stats on the server with our session ID. And this is called on our server, right? Load stats on server. This gets called on the server. That is our session ID being passed through. So for some reason, this is being called incorrectly, I think. We're going to have to test this out. So let's, I don't know why I did that. I don't need to do that. I have my node server and I can print out when somebody brings in information. So that would be our get character info from server. So let's do a console log. This way we don't actually have to change our server for now. Let me build out my server. I got like four things I'm doing at once. Let me build this out while I update the code here. So console log. And then this would be the ID plus socket ID plus call da session ID blah 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 session ID. There we go. Okay, so hopefully that will fire out our changes that we want. Get it to burn. How can you switch from my character to another character? Do you mean at runtime or do you mean at design time, Zelotti, for switching your character? Tudis, I'm always going to be busy, so there's nothing I can do about that. You can't link them to YouTube directly, but if you've removed like the period from the .com for wherever you're uploading it to, it'll go up and I can grab them, so that won't be an issue. You'll just have to make it look like it's not a link, basically. That's the node server again. It's the way YouTube works. It's really, really annoying. Okay, cool. So let's go back to our maps, login screen, go back to play, log in. I failed miserably on my map for some reason. Holy moly. Oh. Yeah, that doesn't help that I did that, does it? I tried to start up a listen server and dedicated server at the same time. That was not the most appropriate thing to do in the world. The computer, the server freaked out. There we go. Okay, cool. Okay, so our server is saying that this is our session ID and this is our client stupid socket session ID and server session ID. When we do that, and then if we log in our second character here, which we can see it has the same stats, our second character is actually requesting a completely different set of info. So we are getting a completely separate set of info. So that shouldn't be the problem here. So where is this updating? You want to bet, let's say this is our HUD for our player, right? So is this going to be an issue on my side? Let's find out. So let's see, recruit character info, update mod stats. This updates all of our local stats. Oh, you know what I can do? I can check and see if, oh, that's what I was gonna do. Okay, here. This is always fun, trying to test multiplayer. I just thought of something. Okay. So AWES, 610 coins, blah, 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 blah. And okay. So this is incorrect. So the correct stats are being brought in. That's what I was trying to double check. So this isn't an issue with us getting the wrong stats. This is an issue with us displaying the wrong stats. Somehow we are getting the stats from the other character when we're displaying that, which honestly makes almost no sense to me, but I have a feeling it might be related back to our locally controlled that we did earlier. So the cool thing is it should be pretty simple to check out. So when our HUD is displayed, so let's find our HUD. So let's find our HUD right here. That is our character card. And these are our stats for our character card. All this stuff is pulled in. It's given to us, so it's got nothing to do with the display. So it has to do with our HUD itself. So right here. So here's our HUD itself. And this is the update target card, which we were looking for. So it's going to... Oh, not the target card one. We want the player's card. So we want the character card. Why is our character card not being done one at a time? See, no, this is the character stats. Did I do something really stupid? Here's the target card. Here's the character card. Okay, here's the character card. This is what I was trying to find. Create the character card. Create the character card. Add it to our widget. Do I never set the stats anywhere for the character card? I have to update the stats somewhere, right? It's got to be the local character that's doing it. Okay. So let's find our character. Well, this right here shows that I did this. This system is in the wrong place. This is not in the right place. Yeah, see, update character card all. This is definitely in the wrong place. Yeah, it should be updating. Oh, that's funny. Okay. So at least I know where the problem is here. Okay, Z-Lottie, yeah, give me a second, Z-Lottie. And DDL, can you make more videos about physics and thrust? I can definitely do that. I will add them to my list. I know I need to add more stuff on physics. Physics involves math. Math is my mortal enemy, so I tend to run into issues when I'm doing things related to math. But I will definitely add those to my list. I definitely know there is more things on physics that should be covered, like impulses, thrusts. There's another one in there I can't remember. But yes, I will add more stuff to my list about physics. I will do that. Let's see, Z-Lottie at runtime. So what you want to do for changing a character at runtime is you need to use the possess and unpossess nodes. That's basically what it is. I've done a small example of that at one point in my playground. And we have the character, where is it? Character spawning, character creation. What did we call this thing? Swap characters, here we go. So this is our swap characters map. If I go over here, it changes to a green character. And I also had it set up where there was a menu, but I didn't put it in there. It looks like there's another one over here, maybe. Whoops. Yeah, there we go. When you click the button, it allows you to change. So you can see I can change between a red dude and a green dude if I had this set up properly, which, you know, this was for testing purposes. It's possessing and unpossessing. So you'll see when I start the game on my character right here. And this is my, where's my character in here? My player, that's my controller. Where's my character? Is swap character, here we go. Here's my character, swap. Let me make sure that's my character. Swap character default. Is that him? Let's delete it and find out what happens. Yeah, okay, so that was the correct character. I wanted to make sure it was. It also doesn't, I wonder if we just ran into a crash error. I don't think it liked me deleting the player in the middle of what we were doing. Oh, that's something to know. Let's see if our task manager just broke. Nope. What? It's compiling shaders. Seriously? I accidentally hit launch and it's compiling shaders. Okay, so unfortunately I can't show you what I want to show you right now because it's being a giant pain in my rear. You know what? Let's see if I can actually. We're gonna go with this one. There we go, cool. I managed to kill it. That's what I was trying to do. Okay, sorry about that, Zilotti. Let me show you this again. Apparently don't hit the launch button. It causes your game to try to launch itself, which is not what I wanted to do. Okay, so what did we swap characters? There we go. Okay. So how this is set up is the game spawns in my default character. When I go over here to this little thing over here, we now spawn in a green character. If you look over here, it's called swap character 2. How the code works is if we look at the code, if I can click on my little box, here we go, and we edit it, and we wait for it to open, there we go. What we're doing is when we go into this box or we push our button, apparently I set up a button, which I didn't remember, we are remembering where we currently are because we're basically swapping to a different character in the exact same spot. But what matters is this code right here, these three nodes. Let's move this over. We are destroying ourselves. The controller, the character controller, is what controls your character. So it's what actually is where your input's coming in. The actor or the character that you're controlling is just the, you know, the physical representation of yourself. So if we destroy the actor, it's fine. We still have ourself and we still can control things in the world if we possess them. So we destroy ourself. So in this case, I'm destroying that gray actor so we can get rid of it. We don't want it anymore. Then we spawn in the new one that we want. So in this case, I'm spawning the green one. And then we possess what we just created by our player controller. So these are the three nodes that you're going to care about for swapping characters from one to the other. If you just want them to swap and you don't want them to get destroyed, for example, I'm not switching from a red Power Ranger to a blue Power Ranger. I'm just going from the red Power Ranger and now I'm going to control the blue Power Ranger. I still want the red one to be there. Then don't destroy the old one. You want to unpossess. So we, for example, grab this one and unpossess. Now we got to grab the character controller. And call unpossess on the controller. And what that does is it says, hey, controller, you're now controlling nothing. So instead of destroying, we're just going to unpossess. And then we'll go ahead and spawn in the new one or grab whatever we want to now possess and possess it. So those are what matters, the possess and unpossess nodes. This is what matters. This is what you care about. And you need to give it something to possess or you need to tell it when you want to unpossess whatever's there. And then either destroy what you don't want anymore and spawn in what you do want, or just keep a reference to things that you do and don't want. So you could, for example, the game starts up, you spawn in five different enemies, you keep track of, you know, enemy 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, and then you possess and unpossess whichever ones you want appropriately. That's how you would do switching from one character to another. Let's see, trying to make your character hover, but it's not being very helpful. Hovering is a pain in the butt. Are you trying to make hovering work in regards to having proper physics collisions? So for example, if you have a mountainous terrain, the hover is always going to try to stay, you know, 20 or 30 above the ground. If so, what you do is you just use a lot of line traces and you apply force up or down based on where it's at. There's a really good example, if I can... Let me see if I can pull this example up again, because it was a really cool example. Did I bookmark it? Was I smart enough to bookmark it, finally? I don't think I was. I don't tend to be smart enough to remember things. I didn't bookmark it, of course. Let's see if we can find it. Let's see, vehicle. Let's see, so let's go to Google, first of all, because Bing is a giant pain in my butt. Vehicle, physics, UE4, line, trace. Here's a hover vehicle blueprint, which would probably work, but there's a really cool vehicle physics fun trace arcade. I'm trying to find here we go. This is one I was looking for. And I'll throw this into the chat. This is a really good video on how they cover how they did their vehicle physics. And even though the vehicles are on the ground, you'll notice not all of them are, like this little guy right here is technically a floating thing, but it covers in about 7 minutes the basics of how you do a line trace arcade physics racing system. But the nice thing is it goes from, as soon as I can show it, here we go, it goes from scratch, a basic block, and then it shows you as it goes through there the math behind the physics. You're faking wheels basically and load balancing and things like that. And it shows you how they set up line traces and force to keep it off the ground. And you can see right here, it's what it is. And this, because it's using line traces at key points, you can have it apply the appropriate amount of distance you want from the ground. And you can see like there, well, right, wherever that was at, that guy's kind of like hovering. It's like an arcade physics system. You can see right here, see? But this is a good start for a basic system. You're looking for something like this. You're going to use line traces to basically push it off the ground to whatever distance you want. Will this work if you attach it to motion controls? Do you mean like VR motion controllers? If you are, it shouldn't really matter. All you're doing is, instead of using real physics like a wheel that keeps things off the ground, you are just simply using distance checks with a line trace and applying the appropriate amount of physics down or up based on how high or low you want to keep it off the ground. It should work with anything. I mean, it's independent of your input type stuff. It should work. It should work independently. It should work for, yeah. What's the best way to optimize a jungle with a lot of shadows? Don't use a lot of shadows, or use a really small shadow draw distance. Distance field shadows might work. That's one of those things I really can't help with. I'm not an artist, and you can see the art we're using in our game right now. It's nothing. I can't help you with that. I'd say go to the forums is about all I could say. I'm not an artist and I have almost no experience in optimization for the art. I wish I did, but I don't. Okay, so we need to fix this. So, okay, so I know why this is happening. Let's see if we can, figure out where we are calling this at. We actually need to, I guess I need to put this in each of these would be the smart place to put it. Yeah, let's do this. We're only going to update the card if it's locally controlled. Because, yeah, this is that same issue we ran into. So what was happening, this is my best guess, is what's happening. We're going to actually have to test this and see if this is what was happening. But it's the same thing with our targeting setup. Because we have the client version of this character and the server version of this character, and then the other client version of this character, so three versions. Technically, this code was working good, except bad. It didn't fail because it was getting it was only updating the HUD that was appropriate. So only my HUD was updating. I wasn't updating your HUD, for example. The problem was every version of this character was calling this code and talking to my HUD. So the server version, the client version, and then the client 2 version were all telling my HUD to update itself with the stats because of the fact that this will technically only ever return my HUD as the local person, but I never specified only do this if it's the local version of this character. So that's something to keep in mind. That's why this is a lot of fun trying to remember what should and shouldn't be done when you are working with multiplayer. But it also makes it a fun learning experience because it does. Okay, so this should... If I was correct with my assumption, and I can remember how to friggin' move a node, and we'll save everything out, we'll kill the server, we'll go ahead and save everything. This should fix the issue with the wrong name and stats showing up on the HUD. So this wasn't an actual issue with our server, this was an issue with the code we've implemented yesterday, which I kind of thought it might have been due to the fact that I never touched the server and it used to work 2 days ago. So that's what always makes it fun. It also that's what makes this kind of a pain in the butt when you're working and stopping. You kind of don't ever finish checking stuff. But that's what our dedicated debugging team is for. And yeah, Tudis, I won't be leaving anytime soon. I'll probably have at least 45 more minutes. I don't know how much I can help you. I can't guarantee anything. I can try to look at it and see where it goes from there. More than likely, if it's going to take more than a little bit of time, I'll probably just do it off stream, see if I can help you out, and then reply back with the answer. I don't know. I'll find out shortly. Let's see. Ned, anyone can help me out. A blueprint system for changing rounds per minute in a weapon, please. Let's see. Rounds per minute. It sounds like it's just a simple... time check. How are you currently choosing to fire off your weapon, or you have no? Does your weapon have no delay built in? Is that the issue? Yeah, determining fire. It's basically the firing rate is what you're trying to change. Do you currently have a firing rate set up in your weapon? Okay. So here's our main guy. AWES. We're good here. We'll fire up our second guy. Now, hopefully, our mage will actually have his correct stats. And he does not. We've definitely fixed our problem, but we've definitely done something wrong because of this right here. Which is fine. This is what we're working on. We have... Okay, and we managed to crash our server. That's kind of cool. Huh. That's not never a good sign. We crashed our dedicated server somehow. Let me see if we can figure this out, shall we? That was kind of cool. Okay, so it's... You know what's kind of weird, too? It's only our second character. You guys notice that? Only our second character is having an issue with the wrong stats. We're getting the right stats back because this is all the right stats. He's a warrior. He's got 100 health. This one over here is a mage with 50 health with the dame. So we're getting the right stats back. It's just our display is not updating properly. And then did we crash the server again? No, okay. So the good thing about this is we can actually debug it. So that's what's nice. Let's go ahead and fire up our first client as a remote client right here. He should be good. and we can see he's good. Then we can now run this in here, and we'll run it inside of our editor. Oops. And we will grab our character, and we're going to find where we update this stuff at. So that's going to be probably in here. So let's go into here, and let's put a debug. And let's go ahead, whoops, and log in. And fire off debug. Let's see. Okay, so let's see. That's the correct HUD. And our player values are right here. And do we not have the proper player values back from the server yet? So let's stop this. Let's go ahead, go into our character. Let's find out where we're updating our card at. We're updating it in card all. Let's find the reference to that. We're calling it right here. This is a stupid delay. Why is the HUD crash created later? Yeah, we ran into that issue. This loads the stats on the server, so that should be fine. Let's go back to here. So update character card is not... firing off properly. So let me do something really stupid here. We're going to put a 3-second delay before we actually update the stats. And then we're going to walk through the stats completely. For testing purposes. So this will go in. There's our card, which is what we expected to be blank. Then it pauses. Then we have update character card. We'll skip. This updates everything. We'll skip. We'll go into the health. We'll skip through here. This is going to see if it's locally controlled, which is giving us back a false. So we will resume. And we're now back in here. This is our update character card at all. We will skip. We'll skip. We'll skip. This one should give it back a... it's giving back a false also. Huh. This is character, huh? Okay, I'm gonna tell you right now, I am confused. We're gonna figure this out in a second. That is super duper confusing. Let's see, what can help with landscape collisions? I don't know, unfortunately. I don't play with landscapes much. The default collisions should be fine. If not, you could always set up a... well, what's the problem with your landscape collisions? Because are they too intense, or are they not working right? Because the default collision system should work fine with landscapes. I guess I should ask the question of what the actual problem is. Okay, so why is this not being called properly on the locally controlled character? This is called on the client. Each of these clients call this. They store their IDs on the server. They load the stats from the server. Our HUD is created properly. This probably only needs to be called... I just realized that this is an issue. Okay. I just realized that something here. I realized that this code should be somewhere else, because this character card should only be created locally. So I think we have a problem here. Here, let's figure this out, because there's a definite problem here. Locally controlled, okay. Locally controlled by local controller. Yeah, this should be fine. Okay, let's do a print string. Yeah, let's do a debug check right here. Okay, let me kill. I also just realized this might not be firing off because I didn't rebuild the server, but let's just test this. Okay, let me see. Let me download a file as well. coffee. Let's see what happens here, shall we? tinyearl.com. Simple server browser. That's a very large file. This might not go over very well on my side. Mainly because it's, yeah, see, I'm not going to be able to, yeah, this might end up causing, oh, double crap. I forgot to shut down a few things. Yeah, I can't build because of the fact I had this server still running, so that didn't help. I don't know how much this is going to screw up my bandwidth for recording. How much of the recording is having an issue right now for anyone who might be watching? I'm definitely losing most of my bandwidth from the download. That finished. Let's see. I don't know what's gonna happen, so I apologize if we run into any issues. We'll just see what we're doing. Yeah, I have a feeling there's gonna be a little bit of lag. Okay, true. Okay, so that one updated fine. That was weird. That one said true. I had one of them say true and then one of them say false, which it should have because the server should be fine. Okay. What the hell? Yeah, client one true. Okay. So that's exactly how it should be. True. Okay. So that one's fine. True and false. Okay, and false. Okay, cool. Never mind. Okay. It's fixed. I just didn't build this out to the server, is all. Okay, cool. This is fixed. This fixes it. The funny part is we don't need those locally controlled in the other spots. So I was correct. The issue with testing was I didn't build out the server between testing. I always got to remember to do that. So just to summarize this, I gotta stop saying so many times. Even though we are on the client, we are not on the server when we execute this code. We are grabbing our local instance. We're saving our local instance to the server. We're loading up the stats locally to this version. This code right here, which created the character card, which is the little heads-up display and updated the stats on the card. Even though it's technically calling it locally on the local version, the non-server version, we have to remember, and this is what has driven me crazy so many times. Technically, when we have two people connected to the server, I'm going to have two local versions of these characters. I'm going to have my version of my character and my version of your character. But both of them are technically not on the server. They're both Switch has authority remote. The difference is one of them is locally controlled, the one I'm controlling that I care about the HUD for, and the other is not locally controlled because it's my version of your client, which you're controlling, so it's not controlled by me. So yes, there's a lot of really ridiculous checks you have to do on networking to make sure you are talking to or having the correct thing talking. And that was an example of it right there. So let me go ahead and bear with me for a couple seconds. Let me see about opening the project that I was sent. Let me see if there's anything I can help with on the project and we'll go from there. So it's extracting right now and we'll go from there. And your issue is that you're bringing up to this is you are unable to successfully swap weapons over a network situation. While it loads everything up, it's extracting right now. Hopefully, that I just realized that hopefully isn't killing the server either, because everything touches the server, which is funny. The server, the streaming stuff. Okay. So server browser, let's see. Let me open it up. Now I'm gonna open this up off screen just because I don't know what the contents are and I don't know about any of the stuff that's in here. So bear with me for anyone who is watching. It should take me a minute or two just to browse through here, see if I can really quickly figure anything out. And then see if I can help out. It looks like it's probably compiling shaders, because why not? Yep, compiling shaders, because why not? Hopefully there's not too many things. I did see a bunch of materials, so I guess we'll have to figure it out. That's opening. We can go on work on other stuff. There's no reason we can't do that. Okay, I think we fixed our bugs. It looks like we fixed our bugs. Let's double check again, because why not? I kind of just assumed we fixed our bugs right there. I also think did I crash the server? Did I kill the server again? Oh yeah, I deleted some stuff. I need to rebuild out the server. You know, this is just a fantastically weird day where I just cannot remember anything today. Let me kill this server. We don't need that one. Let me kill that and kill that. There's my node server. There we go. So his project's opened up. So we'll wait for those to compile shaders. This is going to build out that. Basically, we're just waiting on stuff to happen. Yep, Tudis, give me a second. We'll check that out here in a second. It's shaderizing. There's really nothing I can do while it's shaderizing. And we're waiting for this to build out. Yeah, it's got a couple, what do we got? 2,000 shaders or so to compile. This one's building out. This one should be done in a second. We'll double check. We'll see if we got the UI fixed. Then, I mean, as stupid as it sounds, after roughly an hour, we actually ended up finishing up the work we started on Wednesday. Because even though you make stuff work, it doesn't actually mean it works until you test it. Okay, cool. Build successful. We'll go ahead and fire up the dedicated server again. We'll go ahead and log in. Actually, let's log in with two different remote clients. So that would be in the folder that I just closed on accident. So let's try that again. Staged builds editor. Here we go. We'll log in. Let's log in backwards this time just to make sure. So this should load our mage up. And his name is DDDDD with his stats. He's got 50 health and 100 mana, so we know he's good and proper. Now we'll load up our warrior. And we'll see what he comes out with. His name is there properly. He's got 100 health and he's got 100 stats. So there we go. We are able to fix our display issue with our server stuff. We should also be able to attack, have the appropriate things targeted, and both people should be able to attack, and the damage should go down quicker. And obviously we just broke something. Gosh darn it, what did I break? Probably because he didn't go aggro. Okay, so he wasn't on the aggro list is what happened, and that's why his name didn't fix. So we need to fix that at some point. And we still need to fix this. The monster died, but we have no clearing. What's funny is that's technically what we started on this morning, and we haven't even gotten to it yet because of all the other crap we had to do. Okay, so let's see, his project is up. Let's go ahead and see if we can do this. He's got set to two players, so we'll run two players here. I'm assuming multiplayer. I don't know, let's turn this one on host, I guess. Or I guess the other one was server browser host. Well, that didn't work because that locked it up. So that actually locked it up. Whoa. Okay, then. It did not like me doing that. I have a feeling it did like me doing that because I had my dedicated server run at the same time. Oh boy. Okay, so that's something of note. Don't do that. Okay, so let's kill it. And let's try that again, shall we? Okay. Take two. Fire up this up. I have my dedicated server off this time, so hopefully we won't run into an issue. Yeah, it should work, but it doesn't mean it does work, and I've never used this before, so I technically have no idea how it even works. There we go. Okay. And then multiplayer, server browser, find games. See, I'm using a dedicated server without a server browser, so I've never really used this. But the server browser certainly isn't finding it. Okay, so you have, see, I'm definitely not in, we are definitely not in, we are not synced at all here. You have, okay, let's start this back up. How do you, okay, I've done nothing. How do you want this thing to connect properly? How are you supposed to connect to multiplayer? I mean, multiplayer and then host game? Because that loaded up the host. And there's a guy here that doesn't even technically count. I'm guessing this is your just a default person you have spawned in. Probably. But then, what? Multiplayer and server browser? Doesn't find the game. I don't have, yeah. Type, okay, so I have to type two while hosting? Okay. So then we try this. There we go. Okay. Cool. Okay. Except I spawned in spectator mode, it looks like, on this client. This client didn't spawn in as a character. Maybe it killed it on collision. So let's move my character. Let's try that again. Host, move him out of the way. Multiplayer, server browser, fun games. Game should pop up. Join the game. No, I'm coming in as a spectator. I'm not spawning in as a player. So do I need to do three? Since you technically already have someone in the game? Let's try three. Well, actually, let's see what the error is. Lots of errors. Yeah, because it doesn't exist as a third person. Yeah, let's try this again. Move him out of the way. Multiplayer, server browser, find games. Okay, yeah, it's definitely not loading in. Okay, so the other way, just do I have to host and then open the map? Or do you just want me to open the map without hosting? Like this. I think I saw, right? Yeah, because I'm not seeing the same people in the game here. So this guy's here, and this guy's not here. Okay. 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 I'm here. The game is not running. Start the game and then do what? How do you traditionally get into this for testing purposes? Because I can't even get two people in the same server running properly at this point. Or you need me to open the map inside the editor and then hit play. I guess that could be it. Okay. Like that. There you go. Okay. Yeah, your server lobby is completely non-functional. Okay, so we have two different people in the game now. Okay, there we go. And the tab button switches the weapon. Looks like it's working to me. Unless I'm confused, because the guy on the left just changed to that gun. The guy, yeah, it's working for me. I mean, there's the red gun. I hit tab, and there's the black gun. I mean, that's what you expect it to work, right? Unless I'm confused. Granted, it's just exploding when I use this weapon, but that's not a big deal. Yeah, weapon swap seems to work fine for me. The other player, okay. So the client's weapon swap is not working properly. That's what you're saying. Gotcha. Okay, so we know the client version's, the server version's working. It's the client version we can't get working. So let me go like that. Okay. You'll notice, okay. I can't point with my finger because my finger can't be seen through the screen. You'll notice when that happens, the animation's playing, but you're swapping the weapon on the server. So that's an indicator of an issue that we have right there. So the animation itself is playing. It's just that you're not actually swapping at any point the actual weapon. Okay, so let's find our character then. First of all, we don't need him in here, but why not? Let's see if we can look through our code and figure this out. Then let's find our swap weapon code, which is hopefully, there we go, input action swap weapon. So tell server to equip, which is a run on server. So this code right here, no matter what, is always going to tell our server to equip the weapon. So the server version of ourself should equip its weapon when we run this. And then tell the client to equip is, well, this does nothing right here. All this does is tell the client to equip it. Okay, and then tell the client equip is equipping, delays, set is equipping. I'm guessing these things are anim blueprint related. Let's see, what anim blueprint are we using in here? We got it. Yeah, okay, so let's see, this is our default stuff, this is our is equipping stuff, where's our is equipping, which swaps our weapon like that. Okay, so the is equipping starts our animation just to pull it backwards, and then let's see, what else do we got, let's see, and these are anim notifies, which then, okay. So there's a couple things in here. This right here, get player character 0, will always return the local character no matter what. So this right here is basically saying, if this, for example, if the server version gets this code called, it's going to say, okay, grab my local character, grab myself, and tell myself to do this. Even if the server, your client, your second person called this code, if this ever gets called, no matter what it gets called on, this is always referring to the local player only. So that's something to keep in mind. This is probably why the server is changing the weapon when the client changes its weapon. Because you're telling the server to change its weapon. Because this code ends up getting called on the server. Let's see, what is a good way of doing this? Let's see. What does test do? Only on the server we run test 3. That is a lot of stuff with the same names. Which equips actor, which calls gets the local player, and then tells it the main weapon is equipped, and then attaches the weapon. Okay, or unattaches the weapon, it looks like. So that's not an issue. So what is the appropriate way of doing this? The animations themselves seem like they're running fine. It's not a case of the animation not running. Because if we run this... Okay, move our little guy over. Here's our client. If we run this, the animation runs. So we don't have an issue with the animation playing and unloading. The issue is with our notifies. Basically telling the server to change rather than the client to change. And it should be the server version of... Okay, off the top of my head, this is my first thought of what's happening, and then we'll try to see if we can figure this out and go from there. This is our client, and this is our little dude right here on our client. It's this guy right here, which is this guy right here. This is our server dude, and this is the server version of that dude. But this is the client's version of the server version of the dude. When we tell it to unequip, we're telling the server to call the code. And the server runs the code, not a problem. That's why we're seeing the animation run on this guy. When it gets to the anim notify, the server code is not saying, hey, local current character, the actor I'm currently attached to or the actor I'm currently running this animation on, I need you to do something. It's saying, hey, get me player zero. Player zero will always refer to the local player, which means it's going to be this character right here. And it's telling it to swap its weapons. That's why when this runs, you'll notice the weapon changes halfway through. Because we are telling the server version, this character right here, to swap its weapon. So what we want to do is to do, first of all, you're in the third person character. You don't need to do this. You're already here. This is just saying, hey, grab the local character, not ourselves. So this is kind of pointless, especially since main weapon equipped is right here. We don't need... what we need is we'll grab main weapon equipped. We'll get this, delete, delete, delete. Put this here. Because you want this weapon swapping on the local. You want this weapon swapping on here. Okay, and then this is the target, which was probably ourselves. Set secondary weapon equipped, which is right here. So set, and we set that unchecked like that. Okay, this, I don't know what's gonna happen when we do this, but this means only change this on this version of the character, not necessarily a different version. Because this right here, this code right here, player character zero, this could return you back a completely different character than the one we're currently in. And you want this code to run on the one we're currently in, I'm assuming. That's the whole point of this code. So let's just see what this does right now, just from a simple test purpose. Okay, so that is still calling on the server. So we need to look at anywhere else we have our get player zero code. But I'm still tracking stuff down. We're just cleaning up some code right now. Unequip is probably the same thing. Yep, you only want to call this locally. So let's switch this over to main weapon equipped and put this in here like this. And then we are going to, let's see, set main weapon equipped. So set main weapon equipped to yes, and you'll notice that these are different nodes, which is important. This one has no target. That means it's the local version of this variable. This one has a target, which means it's any version of this variable. You tell it which one. And this one we want to see secondary weapon equipped, yes, and main weapon equipped, no, and then we can delete these versions, hook them up. Let's see if we can slowly start knocking out some stuff. Okay, let's see what happens here. This is just the easiest way for me to figure this out without going through literally all the code. Whoops, I clicked on the wrong monitor. There we go. Sorry about that. Okay, swap weapons. Okay, so we are still calling it on the server, which is what I was curious about. But you'll also notice now, though, on the client, I thought it was working. Is it working? No, okay, cool. Okay, yeah, that's fine. That's good. This is cleaning up the code. That's what we're working on right now. But I did notice in our Anna blueprint, you have get player character notes. These are probably the things we're going to have to change, more than likely. Because do these ever get called? Are these nodes ever getting called? Because these nodes are technically the same ones that are in here. Oh, crap. Let's see. Okay, so equip weapon. Yeah, this one's always going to get our local character. So this is definitely an issue here. So how are we going to fix this? Can't we get whoever this Anna blueprint is attached to? Isn't that what... get pawn owner is what it is. Is what we'd probably want. So, let's replace this with get pawn owner. Yeah. So let's replace all of our get player characters with pawn owners. I don't think these ever get called, but I'm gonna breakpoint them just to double check. Here, let's try that. Move you over here. Move you here. Tab key. There we go. See? Now we got it working. And then this one should successfully swap its weapon too. There we go. Okay. And then he'll swap his weapon. There we go. Okay. So you have code everywhere, but what matters is we're trying to make sure we talk to the correct ones. For multiplayer, it is extremely important to remember that when you run the get player character, when you feed in zero, that means it's always going to refer to the local version of the player character. And keep in mind, there are multiple versions of every stupid character in the game for every character you have in the game. Two people playing, you could have four different versions of the character, or six different versions. Authority stuff could be involved in this, and might be involved in here at some point, but that only kind of really matters on if you're not replicating things. And from the looks of it, I was really quickly running through this, obviously, trying to figure out what does what, because there's so much testing stuff in here. But yeah, you have this set to multicast. Yeah, this is fine. So this right here is exactly what you wanted. Where'd the key button go? Where I lost it? Oh, crud. Where'd the weapon toggle go? Oh, here we go. Swap weapon. So this, a lot of this stuff is 99% not needed. I mean, this one goes here. This one goes here. This tells the client to equip. This one runs through here and sets the weapons. And then I'm guessing you have, but these, are these notes ever called? Were these ones where I went? It was this one, right? This was the note that was called in here somewhere? Yeah, test, okay. So this is why you don't need the client and authority stuff. This is what I was trying to friggin' backtrack my way to. You're telling the weapon to change. You're telling it to start the animation. So, there's so much stuff we're backtracking through here. That's fine. Yeah, okay. The client says, hey, we're going to swap our weapon. It tells the server it's going to equip the weapon. Then the server tells the client it's going to run the weapon, equip the weapon. And even though this says tell client to equip, you've got it set to run on server. This right here, these three nodes are doing the same thing. This is all useless. Just an FYI. This is saying on the server, we're going to go ahead and equip the weapon. So that's good. That means our server, or our server version of our character, wants to equip its weapon. And it runs our little event right here. When our Anna blueprint gets that notification so that the weapon is changing, is equipping and all that stuff, it tells its version of itself. So in this case, the server version of itself. So the server version of client 2 or the server version... God, it's so hard to put names to this. I'm just going to call it server and client. I know it's kind of silly, but when we run this code here, the server is running it, but the server is talking to your version of your character on the server. That's what this node, why this node was important. That's saying, hey, make sure you talk to the correct version of this character. When you did the get player zero, you're saying, hey, talk to a completely different person. Yeah. But then when you run your test code here, remember I said this is probably going to be as simple as making sure we run a multicast? Your test node runs from the server and does a multicast. That's right here, which is our multicast. When this runs, it tells everybody to call the equip weapon code. And then now that we've got the code set up to call the local version of equip weapon, then the server changes and all the clients change at the same time. So yeah, just make sure you basically change your get player zeros inside of your character to the local version of the variables, not the get player zero version. And then make sure the anim blueprint changes to the try get pawn owner. And this is really super easy to find, because if you go back to how the code starts up, you can see it right here. This is saying, hey, who owns this animation? That's what this is right here. Okay, I want that as the third person character. And then that's when you run your little check here. So hopefully that helps. Obviously, I should not say hopefully, considering we got it working. Same as a little dude go, no, my gun's changing. Yay. Still other stuff has to work on, but you know, you'll figure that out. Like, we don't have any actual... oh no, there we go. Okay, cool. The particle effects respond on the server. I wasn't in the server before to check. Yay! Oh no, I'm out of ammo. Oh wait, there's a reload button. There we go. Cool. Yep, cool. Okay, cool. So hopefully that helps. Let's see, we've been streaming about an hour and 37 minutes. I don't remember what we were working on. I do remember what we were working on fixing something, right? Oh yeah. Let's see if we can get our target bar to disappear, and then we'll wrap up today. So we need some way of knowing that when our target has died, it removes itself from the current target of anybody who is currently has it targeted, is what we need to do. So how do we want to do that? What's the easiest way of doing this? We've already got an event dispatcher set up for damage, right? Let's see. Let me close all of these stupid things that I don't need here. Okay. So here's our custom event grab on. Here's our rep for our current target. So when our current target changes, we go ahead and update our UI, and then we go ahead and we bind an event to value change. So when the value changes, we have our event here. Which is going to be our listen for value changed ED. Okay, so you know what? I bet you we can really simply fix this to really quickly cheat. And I bet you we could really quickly do this. Trying to find where the stupid listen for a value. Where did I put it? I literally have it in here somewhere, don't I? Okay, I need to start commenting these. Hold on a second, because this is stupid. Coins. It just makes it really hard to see stuff when you're zoomed out. Toggle character stats, handle attack, tower attack, do auto attack, check for valid target, toggle amount of mouse. Yeah, we don't need to... Oh, that's right. Yeah, that was our code in the other spot. Seriously, I called the event. Listen. Oh, it's down here. Son of a gun. Listen for events change ED. I knew I had it in here somewhere. I just couldn't figure out where I put it. Okay. Oh, and if I was smart, I would have expanded this and I could have gone right to it. Well, that was silly. Make a thrust tutorial before leaving. DD, I don't think I'm going to be able to. If you can maybe comment on this video with the exact information you're looking for, I'll see if I can do something over the weekend. I've only got a little bit of time left for right now. Update target card. What we want to do here is... let's do something really silly. Oh, you know what? I just realized that this isn't even going to work. Okay, sorry about that. I have a feeling... yep, right here. Rep current health, update the monster health. I have a feeling... where's my monster death code? I have a feeling I'm not even going to replicate this. Set with notify, spawn default, set value. Let's see, where's my death code? Where's my death code? Here we go, damage. Okay. Take damage. Set the current health. Let's see, set current health. On rep notify, we'll list. Okay, no, Brian. No, so this will work. Okay. I was trying to see if the values would still change even if the monster died. That's what I was checking for. So how do we do this properly when the actor itself, I only get the actor and I tell it to up to, oh crud. You know what? I need to make another listen event. Yeah, I'm just gonna have to do this. Listen for value change. Oops, that'd be hitting a new variable button. I don't know if this is the smartest way of doing this, but this is the way I'm going to do it. It, listen for death. From what I've done with Warcraft stuff, I haven't spent a lot of time using the Lua system. A lot of the time you subscribe to events, like for example, chat changes and things like that. And then when they happen, that's when you can get notified. That's basically what the event dispatchers do. So I think we're going to go ahead and just use that as the programming pattern that we're using is what we're going to do. So yeah, we're just going to have listen for death. And then when death is called, we'll go ahead and fire off listen for death. So let me find my event graph for take damage. And then we'll find our death note right here, which is right here. Here's our death note. So we need to, we'll call listen for death right before we destroy the actor is what we're going to do. Whoops, not bind. We want call. There we go. So we'll call listen for death right before we destroy the actor is what we're going to do. To answer the question, Tudis, I stream Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays for about 2 hours a day. Okay, so here we go. So as long as we set up our player to listen for the death whenever they have that targeted, then we will care about it. Then we'll be good. So we'll go back to our character. We'll find our bind event. So when we get our target right here, this is our unbind event, which we need to fix. That's why it's got a giant note. We need to fix this. That's why it's got a giant note. Set with notify is where we do our bind event. So we will do another bind event to death, right? Whoops, I gotta put a space in there. There we go, bind event to list for death. We'll make this a little bit cleaner here. Yeah, it's cleaner. Yeah, I can do that. There we go, even cleaner. Bloop, there we go. And then our event is gonna be, let's see, what do we do on listen for death? We're just gonna clear our target, right? So how do we currently clear our target? Custom event graph, set current target on server to that. Let's see, we don't bind to anything. I'm trying to reuse as much code as we can. I'm trying to reuse as much code as we can. So we're gonna set the current target on the server to nothing is what we're gonna do. There's no point in duplicating code if it works exactly how it is now. So we're just going to call, can we do it from here? Create event, can we call it from here? Set, what was our code called that I just literally forgot? Set current target is going to take in a hit actor, so I don't think this is going to work. Yeah, because my signature is not so. Oh wait, bind event. I'm basically thinking about 10 different things at once right now, trying to figure out if this is the right way of doing this. Yeah. How this, that's right, okay. So how this will be set up is when we have a valid current target, we're gonna listen for its death and listen for when its value's changed. And when it dies, we want to basically change. You know, I can just make a death event. You know what? That would be smarter to do. You know what? That would be smarter. Custom event. Current target died. That way we can do any cleanup stuff we need to do. And in this case, it's just going to be this code for now. And we'll call this one current target died ED. There we go. Like we had listed for value change ED, now we have current target died ED. Now we can go back into here and we'll set this up as current target died ED like that. And there we go. So that'll get called. Then we can go back into here and we can unbind. So we need to move our code over here because again, this is all in the wrong spot. Actually, can we unbind all events from an object? Unbind. No, we can't unbind all events from an object. Damn, that would have been useful. Okay, there we go. Okay, let's build out this server. Let's see what happens, and then let's go back to chat as well. Let's see. Can you check the game called Right Click to Necromance? Maybe do a tutorial on how to make it. Right click to necromance. I have no idea. Let's Google right click to necromance and see what it is. Right click to necromance by itch.io. It looks like a basic RTS. Actually, it looks like, okay. Necromancer, resurrect enemies, control them, defeat an army, right click to necromancer, dead bodies, right click. Left click boosts your army, right click brings something back to life. Yeah, it's an interesting concept. I think I've seen a game like this before. It's kind of like a swarm type game. Let's see, let me pull it up. You're moving, stuff dies. You got basic RTS AI. I could think about it. I don't know. This is the game, in case anyone is wondering. This is the game he's talking about. And it's pretty simple. Basically, left click moves your army around the world. And then right click necromances basically everything that's died into your army. And this is, I mean, this is just basically crowd AI. This wouldn't be too hard. You use just basic AI. You can you'd have like a nav mesh. You can have basic AI move too. The guys aren't really moving when they're standing still. It's just an animation. You can keep track of anything that's dead, and like when you right clicks, for example, you just grab all the enemies that are dead, destroy their dead bodies, and spawn in new AI under your control. And the AI is simply programmed to be within a certain distance of the player or a certain distance of the target, for example. It's definitely an interesting game. I could think about it. I don't really see myself making anything like that, but it might be a fun little project to try at some point. I do not need a gun for the game I'm making right now. This is a classical MMO type game, and I'm using all of the Infinity Blade assets to try to give it a little bit of artwork. Right now we're just trying to fix our stupid death stuff because I can't make it work right. Okay. So if we're lucky, when this thing dies, the health bar will disappear. That is my hope. I should probably up the amount of damage we do back to normal since we're done testing low amounts of damage. Or else this thing literally will take 25 seconds to kill every time. Or I can increase the attack rate. That might work too. We'll figure it out. Let's see if it dies. Well, it'll die, but let's see if its health bar disappears. Crud. It did not. Okay. Oh, but it disappeared there. You guys saw that, right? Unless I clicked on something. Okay, let's increase the amount of damage it takes so we can quickly get through testing purposes. So, where is my, let's see, toggle attack server and do auto attack and damage. Let's just pop out like 10 damage a swing and see what happens. And then let's see, call listen for death. I have it being listened to, and that should be right here. It should call current target died on our custom event graph. So current target died, which I should probably comment. Current target died. Set current target to nothing. It should go through. Remote locally controlled version. Update the target card with the nothing. Check if it's, yeah, this should all work. Okay, so let's double test. Let's do some debugging, see if we can figure this one out. My code seems sound to me. I don't know if it is sound, but it sounds sound. It sounds sound. That was funny. I made myself chuckle. Okay, so this, we need to check and see if that's being called. And we need to see if this is being called properly. That's what we need to do. Whoops, of course. I'm also in the middle of building this, so it kind of didn't like that. So that was silly. There we go. Let's compile everything just to make sure. There we go. And build this out one more time. And hopefully this will work fine. Let's see. Can you make a sacrifice health for mana ability and have auto regen on too as well? I might at some point. That sounds like it would be more of like the shaman, but I'm putting in a cleric. But right now we have zero skills. We barely have anything working. I do have to put in some abilities. I'll definitely have to have some form of auto regeneration in place at some point. So there's no reason I can't have like a clear regenerate spell that gives you extra regeneration. Well, I mean, technically there are reasons why I can't, but I can't think of them yet. Okay. Let's try this. Come on. Come on. Let's actually work like we want to work. Okay. Target. Okay, cool. So our binder is being called. So we're good there. And then we target an, yep, okay, so our binder is being called properly. Our attack's working. Obviously you can see it going faster. And it died. And I got the loot, because I can see the loot on my side. I'm not touching my controller right now. I have a feeling it disappeared because I accidentally clicked like that is what happened. Okay, so we know our binder's working fine. Let's try calling this again. So our binder is being set. This is where we check for life or death right here. This is when we tell everybody to turn auto attack off, which works. And then we destroy the actor. We know destroy actor works. Call listen for death doesn't seem like it worked, because bind event to listen for death. It should call current target died ED, which is our event right here, right? Current target IDD. Okay, so let's try something that simple. We'll put a delay before we destroy. This shouldn't matter, but we're gonna put it in there anyways. And then we'll go ahead and build out. What kind of things are you looking for? Yep, we're just making, okay, so yeah. Right now we are just making a game playable. That's all we're doing. We are getting our basic systems in place for a very small fake MMO type game where people can do stuff. That's all we are trying to do. We're going to eliminate the obvious, and we're going to turn this into hopefully something that's not obvious. Done. I am starting to also feel, because every time I run into an issue, it's something to do with server authority. I'm wondering if this is a server authority issue. Because that tends to be what's biting me in the butt at this point. Okay, so the health did get updated. We saw that time. So we're able to successfully get the health update from the monster because of our delay. Our delay is successfully working properly. Why is call not, why is this not working? We know these two are working. This should work, right? I'm not crazy here. Unless I'm unbinding it early. Let's find out where'd my character go? Where is my binding event? Bind, this should only be bound when I push the left mouse button. Let me double check. Let's click on our target. There's our unbind, which is exactly what we want. And then we'll attack it. We'll try to attack it. We broke something somewhere. What the hell did we break? Okay, our unbind's working fine. Okay, I can no longer untarget things. Okay, someone broke the UI. Gosh darn it. Oh, there we go. Now it's working properly. My, oh yeah. Attack, kill. Well, Craig diddly dud. Okay. So, let's slowly walk through this and see if we can figure it out. When we're setting our current target on the server, we call the set with notify event. This works properly. We've had zero problems with it for our binding event for our value changed. Our value changed event is what is the determines our health. We're also binding to our listen for death. And both of these are proper. I can see them both hooked up proper. This is our event right here that should be called. And then here's our live change. So, I'm curious about something here. Okay, let's see how much this does or does not work. Target, attack, hello. 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 So our binding events are working first. Don't you clear current targets first? What do you mean by clearing current targets? The only time the target itself should ever change is if I click on the left mouse button. Yeah. And the unbind event we tested doesn't get changed. It's just for some reason are the only event that's being, I wonder, what if I flip the orders? I know it's stupid, but what if I just bound just this event? What would happen? I also just realized this is not gonna be on the server, so this is not gonna fire off properly. Yeah, see that event never gets fired off properly. Oh, we also call this on the server. I should be able to bind more than one event, right? I'm not crazy here. I'm not full of cuckoo puffs. Because, I mean, if I can only bind one event, then I can fix this. That won't be an issue. I just don't understand. And, you know, I probably... No, you know what? I don't understand. Why? Yeah. Why would this only work with... Yeah. I'm not crazy, right? Everyone sees it. Not crazy. Same exact type of code set up for a binding. Monsters have this both binding events in there. Signature shouldn't matter. That's not an issue. The call never gets called, even though these things happen. Wait, when am I calling the value changed event? Wait, when do I call the value changed event? Whenever its health gets changed. I'm starting to think maybe this is being called on the wrong... it is a client authority thing. I'm starting to think this is being called on the server and not on the client version is what's going on. Oh, yeah, this is me being... Oh, you know what? I wonder if... What if we did... Okay, yeah, let's try a couple things here, because why not? Of course, I also friggin'... I'm going to try three things really quickly. What we're trying to do is, yeah, basically, once our target dies, we want the widget to be notified to hide itself. Current target died. Seriously? So that got called properly, which is highly amusing. Then it should get called again. Oops. Okay. It should get called again. It's because my target keeps changing because of the mouse click. Okay. And then it's called again. Okay. So, yeah. Okay, let me check something out here. Because we actually had it being called properly that time when I only bound the listen event. Yeah, everything should work. That's the crazy part about this. Everything should work fine. If this works, and then I switch it and it still doesn't work, then I know what I'm going to do. We're going to fix it. It'll get it working. I'm not worried about it from there, and we're done. I'm just slightly confused if this doesn't work the way I expected. Okay, still didn't work. So, it's definitely an issue with client server. This bind right here works fine. However, it's never being called properly. So we know the binding works fine. Because when I switch the binding over to... Where's my... Yeah, I don't know why I've listened for death up. Oh, that was kind of cool. Can't put any code in here, but that's still pretty cool. When I added the listen for death to be called after the value changed on the monster when its health changed, it called it properly, which means on current rep health is being called from the server, which means our graph for here, this is not, wrong button. This is not being called on the properly. So this is only being called on the server. Yeah, so that's where our issue comes from. This is being called on the server for the damage. Everything's being replicated properly. Then this information is being called on the server version, not the client version of it. No. So no, the event dispatcher is being called. Okay. Yeah, I know exactly why this isn't working. The question is, how do we want to set it up? Yeah, no, it's not a problem of removing the widget. This is a case of we have to notify from the we have to notify the client that the monster's died. And I know the issue with this. So what is the smartest way of doing this then? I'm guessing it would be the client version is what we would call. Yeah, I'm thinking I need to do a RPC event. Basically, this server, only the clients can be registered to listen for this call right here. So I can get rid of these things right now. Yeah, only the clients are registered for this. So I need to make sure only the registered clients get this. Which means basically all the clients. So what is the command for? So notify listeners of death. And is how do we do one that's only run on? It dies. I guess we just multicast this? I mean, is that the only way we're going to be able to do this properly? I wanted to have something only run on the clients, but I guess we have to multicast it. We're already on the server, which is stupid, but I need to get this to actually multicast everybody. Okay, so here's what we're going to do. There's a death. We're going to delay for half a second so the monster doesn't disappear immediately, and then we're going to destroy it. I think this will resolve the issue we're having. It seems weird. Yeah. Well, I don't. Yeah. Well, multicast technically calls it on the server. Which seems redundant because I'm already. Well, technically the server, I don't want the server to listen to it. I mean, okay. Technically, I only want the clients to have this notification. The server will never listen for the notification, so it seems stupid to tell the server it needs to notify itself. However, it doesn't seem like there is that option. That's what I was trying to say and failing at. It seems like a waste of a very tiny amount of resources by telling the server to update itself, even though the server's already been updated. It just seemed weird that we can tell the owning client, we can tell the server, and then we can multicast, but we don't have that last option, which is tell everyone but the server. Which is, I know, is silly, but it doesn't mean it doesn't, you know, I don't want to do it anyways. Okay. Now, if we've done this properly, hopefully this will work properly. I think the word properly is going to become my to go with. Yeah, I know. It's probably not even an issue in terms of performance, but I still, there we go. It's one of those things that I always think of. I know it's silly, but it's one of those things I think of. So now if we attack this target, it's going to lose its life, and it should notify that it's lost its life. There we go. We no longer have a valid target by using the existing code. That's what I was trying to do. Now let's see if we can actually have this working with multiple clients, since that's what we technically broke at the end yesterday, or Wednesday. We never tested it properly Wednesday, and we saw what happened. I also think I just started the client up like 10 different times. Nope, okay, only twice. This one's CCC. Okay, good. We didn't break our clients, so those are good. He's gonna target him, and he's gonna, oh, which one am I targeting? Let's target the back one, okay. And he's gonna target him. He's gonna attack, life bars should be synchronized. They both should lose the target. Okay, good. There we go. Okay, so I'm gonna get rid of my debug code that I put in, and then we're going to wrap up today. I did see a couple questions. I'll see if I can help those out. But let me figure out where my debug code went to. Oh, crap. I put debug code in here, and I don't remember where I put it. It looked like it was every time it took damage. Man, I don't remember. Oh, screw it. We'll find the debug code on Monday. Let's see. Can you help out this? I'm making a side scroller. I went to make a level more big, but I can only go high so much. So I'm thinking if there's a way to make a character rotate 90 degrees and continue to make a level on the Y axis. You can rotate the character. That's not a problem. So, where's my playground? Where's my 2D playground? So, like, I probably meant the regular side-scroller, not the 2D side-scroller. But we'll open up the 2D side-scroller. Yeah, so it continues to run to the Y-axis. Now, by the Y-axis... Oh, let me... I meant to open the side-scroller. So, for the Y-axis, are you talking about he's gonna move, like, towards the screen, or you want to rotate the whole thing, and then he runs in that axis? I mean, it's kind of a question there. Because right now, because technically, doesn't he run on the Y-axis right now? Yeah, I mean, by default, if it's a side-scroller, it runs on the Y-axis as it is now. Do you mean, like, for example, he's running sideways, and then all of a sudden, now he's going to run this direction? So he's going to originally run left, right, this way, and then you rotate the camera and the character and have the character rotate, run that way. I mean, you can do that. That shouldn't be too much of an issue, because right now you have, where's our camera? Well, right now in our player, so let's grab our player. And then go to character movement. We have our axes should be locked somewhere in here. Seriously? Let's see, lock, new, restrict, oh, crud. Somewhere in here is our movement restriction, which of course I can't find it, because it doesn't like me. But somewhere in here is our movement restrictions, and this is where you lock your movement on which axis. Oh, here we go. Plane constraint. Here we go. This is what I was looking for. So this is what determines what axis you can move in. So right now it's locked to the x-axis. So when we move left and right, I can only move left and right. But if we... of course, I lost it. You know, you could just switch this to the x, to x0, y1. And then your character should only be able to walk in the one direction. Now, because of the way we have our camera set up, he's not going to be able to do that. But you basically can constrain it, and then you could set it up where he can only walk in that direction, and then you just turn the corner. You want to turn on a corner, he continues to run, it can make the game be indefinite. It's just a lot of changing of code. I mean, we have it where our guy, like I said, you have your camera, and then you have to rotate your camera. So let's say you want him to turn when he hit here. You put up make a blueprint that just has a collider in it that tells the character to rotate, that, or they you know, call it rotating blueprint or whatever. And then when it hits there, then it talks to the character and it tells the character to go ahead and switch its current constraints. So in this case, which of course we'll read down here, you can change your constraints right here. This is where you change them. And it doesn't help that I have certain things. Oh, it's going to be... It's not zero, right? Zero. Yeah. But this is where you can change... I don't even think I'm in the right character, as a matter of fact. But this is where you can change your constraints. Right here. You can see your X, Y, and Z constraints. And that constrains where they can go to. And also works on your movement system. But that's what you're looking at. I can't do it right now, unfortunately. I'm going to have to log out. That sounds like it might be something fun. If you have some difficulty with that still, Stefan, bring it up on Monday or the next time you, if you watch, and we'll see if we can quickly make like a little system where it adjusts the camera rotation and constraints and stuff like that on the side scroller. Yeah, because this is, I don't think this is cooperating for what I want right now, right? Yeah, see, this is definitely not, something's not working right in here, and I don't know why. But I don't play with the 2D, I don't play with the character controller much to know what I don't have set up properly in here. Because I don't have something set up properly in here. I can already tell you right now. I have a feeling it's the, yeah, see, look, now we're doing that, which is funny. I'd have to look through that. Can you make a target system like Dark Souls where you go to fix the camera in the enemy? You know, I haven't played Dark Souls, so I don't, but I'm assuming like a lock-on system where it always faces the enemy. If that's what you're talking about, you can use the find look at rotation node and then just make sure the camera is always facing the character, or make sure the camera is always facing the enemy, which is your target, or the character's always facing the enemy and you keep the camera locked. I can add that to my list of stuff to work on. It shouldn't be too hard, but I can't work on it now. If you still have problems, BJ, just try to catch me the next time I stream and tell me what problems you're having with it. I don't know if I can make a straight system from scratch. Again, I've never really played Dark Souls. I'm assuming you just mean like a lock-on system, like any other type, where you adjust the camera and stuff like that. But for what you're asking about, Stefan, yeah, it's not that hard. You basically, right now with the default 2D template, if I wouldn't have broken it, which I did, it's locked to this one plane. It up and down input and all that doesn't really do anything. So you just rotate the character and rotate the camera, and then left and right now works, you know, on different axes. Billboard materials, they make a health 3D bar move and rotates. I know you could use, you can just do a standard material and you can get a health bar to work in 3D. And you can also give a material to the health bar. I don't really know what you're saying, Stefan. DD, you doing any VR stuff yet? I have done VR. I've got some basic stuff out there on VR. Unfortunately, my VR stuff is packed away and I cannot work on it right now. So I won't be doing any VR stuff in the future. How to make a billboard material. If we're talking about a material that just simply faces the player at all times, then that's not too difficult. That's what we're talking about. I don't like Bing at all. Yeah, this just uses the camera position and sets up a material that should always face the player, right? I'm assuming. If does he actually ever show us an example of this in the world? What? I don't. Oh, wait. What type of, I don't actually see an example. Unless I'm confused, does he actually show this in use anywhere? Like, how would you actually use this for? Okay, yeah, it is a billboard. Yeah, it's just a camera-facing texture is all it is. Yeah. Yeah, that's just a camera-facing texture. Those aren't too difficult to do. It's actually a very similar, kind of like to the a world planar material. When you want to make sure textures are seamless. Yeah, those things are pretty cool. Okay, that's pretty much it for today. I'm gonna have to wrap it up. We hit 2 hours and I've got people alive starting to make noise, so I need to wrap this up. I appreciate everyone hanging out. Let's close this down, not save it. Yep, I appreciate everyone hanging out. We got some good progress. We managed to fix basically all the bugs we introduced on Wednesday, which is always fun. But we are able to successfully now have multiple people look at the same target, have the same information replicated properly, have correct target bars and player cards and bars. All the information, again, replicated properly. Something dies, it cleans itself up. So that's good. We have a very nice and basic simple system where we have all of our data being saved properly. And throughout all of this too, we still have everything saving out to our database server. You can see our coins being updated because that's the only loot I'm giving. So our servers are still working properly like they're supposed to. We haven't touched technically the server in like a week and a half, which has been great. It's just been a lot of stuff on the design end. But now that we have the basic UI stuff working, which is what I was caring about, now we can know when we're attacking stuff and things like that. I think Monday, providing we don't have any other stuff to work on, the next time we work on this, we're just going to start throwing in more usable stuff, like for example making it where the AI actually works properly and can attack the player back, so then we can update the player's health bar properly and maybe handle a basic death loop for the player. I don't really know on that one. I want to get next week the actual game loop working properly. Logging in, doing something, and logging out, and everything you did saving persistently. And I figure for the doing something, we can attack an enemy, the enemy can attack us, we can get loot from the enemy can kill us, we can gain experience from the enemy, and you know, we need to get some form of actual game loop that would, your basics of a game, working next week. And I think we can get it done. And then, once we have our basic game loop, all the other stuff we have, which you can see on this giant list, are basically extensions of that. We have our, you know, NPCs we can start populating in, so we can set up our different NPCs. Because once we actually have loot being given to us, then we can create our inventory. We can store things. Once we have an inventory, we can equip items. We can sell items. We have a reason to have a merchant and an inventory system. We have a reason to check for damage and stuff like that. I mean, we have none of that in there. But we don't have the basics working, so it seems pointless to put an inventory in place if we can't even, you know, do anything with it. So that'll be the next stuff. So next stream will be on Monday. What's that? 14th, 17th. It'll be roughly 10 o'clock Pacific. So 2 hours before now, we'll start working on the MMO stuff like normal. This is the stuff we work on when I don't have other things to work on. So if you have any questions, I will do my best to try to help you out. If not, hopefully we can find somebody who can help you. So feel free to ask the questions. You can also ask them on YouTube. Just put a comment either on the video or in the comment section. I'll try to get to them as I can. I can be YouTube, Beam, and Twitch. Feel free to watch on any of the ones you feel like. You can catch me on Twitter as well when I broadcast. I throw that out there so people can see it. Other than that, that's going to wrap up today's video. Again, I appreciate everyone hanging out. Hopefully everyone has a good rest of their weekend. The video is basically going to die for about 30 seconds before it shuts off, just so I don't disappear. So everyone have a good rest of their day.